Today, if you want to save money, try going green.
Very inexpensive. I think it's like $20, $30 to do all the pipes in the basement.
Keep your freezer and your refrigerator as full as possible. The more full it is, the less energy it will use.
Stay tuned for more earth-friendly advice that will give you more in your wallet. That's next on Canadian Edition. Hello and welcome to the Canadian edition of the 700 Club. I'm David Geirts and glad you could join us for today's program. We continue to pray for people across Canada, and one of the things we get a lot of prayer requests for are about marriages. We know that the society we live in and the times we live in are very challenging indeed, and they're often very difficult for families and particularly for husbands and wives. And so we love to pray with people who need God's intervention in their marriages. And let me just share one of those that has come in recently. Lal and his wife were having marriage problems. His wife left and went to live with some other people. He was concerned and began to pray. He called the 700 Club for prayer, and miraculously, his wife, listen to this, this really isn't funny, but it is kind of humorous, got kicked out of the place where she was living. So she's now wanting to talk and meet with Lal to see if they can reconcile after 40 plus years of marriage. They have some things to work out, but he is excited at what God is doing in his wife and in their marriage, and we're continuing to pray for Lal. God will do some amazing things in response to prayer, and maybe some things we really don't want to have happen, but ultimately, He knows they will be for our good. So if you've got a need in your life today, no matter what it is, but particularly if your marriage needs some prayer, we want to share with you, we want to encourage you, and we want to pray with you. 877-431-7887, 416-431-0700 in the Greater Toronto Area. Call us today because we have prayer warriors that know how to pray for families and pray for marriages. Well, many people think they can't afford to go green because items like a hybrid car and solar panels are expensive. But as Paul Strand explains, going green can actually save you money.
For some reason, many conservative Christians have not embraced the idea of going green. But imagine if by throwing yourself into environmentalism, you could save tens of thousands of dollars a year and get a better relationship with God. The Sleeth family of Wilmore, Kentucky, prove it can be done.
The Sleeth family are Prius driving, bike riding, veggie growing environmentalists. But they're also evangelical Christians.
Matthew Sleeth lays out why every Christian should embrace creation care and serve God, save the planet.
I believe the Bible, and the Bible tells me to take care of creation.
And his wife Nancy shows step by step how it could save you more than $37,000 this year if you implemented all the hundreds of green tips in her book, Go Green, Save Green.
If you drew a Venn diagram of frugality and creation care, taking care of the environment, they overlap about 90% of the time.
At the root of the word conservative, and I'm a conservative, is to conserve.
The Sleeth showed us some of their favorite savings you can get inside your home, like turning your water heater down to 120 degrees.
You don't need water any hotter than what you need for a shower.
Insulate your hot water pipes with these simple sleeves you can cut to length and slip on.
This is a real quick fix.
Very inexpensive.
I think it's like $20, $30 to do all the pipes in the basement.
Matthew also stuffed his attic with insulation a foot and a half thick. He changes the filters for his home's heating and cooling system once a month and gets the system itself tuned up yearly.
It's maintenance people forget about, but you'll actually save money and it'll be safer.
They recommend you heat 3 degrees less in the winter and cool 3 degrees less in the summer. Most of the time they want it cooler, they use ceiling fans instead of the AC. Put up line curtains and install double or triple pane windows that can keep heat in during the cold months and heat out during the hot months. And they've set up a summer kitchen outside so they don't need to use their oven during hot days.
Why should I be turning the heat up in my house by turning it up to 350 degrees and then fighting that with an air conditioning unit?
The Sleeths buy only Energy Star appliances, meaning they're the most energy efficient, and then they use energy saving principles like with their fridge.
You should keep your freezer and your refrigerator as full as possible. The more full it is, the less energy it will use.
They also use the cold rather than colder setting.
The only problem you might have is slightly softer ice cream, but it's not a health hazard at all to keep it on the warmest setting possible.
They also recommend using ice cube trays and disconnecting your ice maker because it uses heat to drop ice cubes into the bucket.
So you're heating up your freezer, which makes no sense. It's like driving a car uphill with your emergency brake on.
When it comes to a washing machine, the Sleeths always use the cold setting and bought a front rather than top loader because it only uses a third of the water.
The water only has to come up to about here, and it throws the clothes through it.
They only wash when there's a full load, though they found they save so much energy hand washing their dishes, they turned their dishwasher into a spice rack. They also didn't buy a dryer, instead hanging clothes in their basement and out back.
It's a solar clothes dryer, yeah.
They admit hanging clothes and washing dishes by hand take extra time, but they use that time as a major source of fellowship, both with each other and with the Lord.
I'm going to go hang the clothes and pray.
But one place you can save time, as well as money and energy, is the bathroom, where Matthew recommends shaving a couple of minutes off your shower, or maybe even trying what the thriftiest showerers do.
Get water on them, turn the water off, then shave, shampoo, all that sort of thing, then rinse off.
And showering, with low-flow shower heads, instead of taking a bath, saves many gallons of water.
About a tenth of what a full bathtub would use.
The toilet is a major waster of water, so the Sleeths recommend placing a brick and 1 gallon jug in each toilet tank.
So each time it uses a gallon and a brick less water to flush.
You can reap big savings by replacing your incandescent light bulbs with compact fluorescents or LEDs. If every household changed just 5...
It'd be the same as taking 8 million cars off the road. And we could shut down 21 coal-fired plants.
All this has brought their power bill down to just $13 to $17 a month. They're also living healthier because of doing things like putting in bamboo floors and getting rid of carpets and fabricated flooring that released harmful chemicals inside. They're making their own cleaning products out of non-toxic substances like vinegar and baking soda. And they're eating healthier and cheaper by consuming more beans and grains, which they buy in bulk, and fruits and vegetables.
Rather than focusing on meat and sweets and prepackaged foods.
And they grow many of those veggies they eat in their own organic garden. All of this, from the bamboo floors to the simpler diet, isn't just about going green, but getting back to the simple basics, because...
The closer you can be to God-made things, the healthier your family will be.
And the Sleeths believe that means spiritual as well as financial and physical health. Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from Wilmore, Kentucky.
You know, this whole idea of going green is not anything new. Creation care is something that God started in the first place. Way back in the Garden of Eden in Genesis 1 and 2, He asked those two first keepers to take care of creation, to go green, so to speak. And it's taken us a long time to realize how critical it is that we do care for the things that God has made in a responsible fashion. And this young couple, who I happen to know of in that particular town in Kentucky, we used to live there, Asbury College and Asbury Seminary are there, and they're going green and saving money doing it. I love one of the things she said. She said this, "The closer you can be to God-made things, the healthier physically and spiritually you will be." I think that's a profound statement. Going green means that we get closer to God-made things. Now, we'd like to help you not just save money, but also to save money by going green in terms of picking up your responsibilities as a steward of creation in creation care. And if you'll call us at 877-431-7887 or 416-431-0700. We have a little brochure we'd be happy to send you called How to Save Money Going Green. 877-431-7887 or 416-431-0700. Well, up next, after a nasty divorce, one woman goes looking for a new man and finds out that the husband she wanted was the one she already had. Steve and Terry Hayes were married for 30 years, but they couldn't have been further apart. It wasn't until they split up that they found the way to grow closer together.
Steve and Terry Hayes married young.
I just turned 17. It wasn't a good marriage. It was, we took advantage and we didn't respect each other and we did a lot of wrong things. We both drank a lot. And when I drank until I couldn't drink anymore.
I got into drugs, you know, it started out small. You know, you do crank or crystal meth. You know, it's something stupid. You do it. You do it once. And it keep calling you back.
Drugs and alcohol were not the Hayes' only problems.
Steve and I never had any friends together. We had separate lives. We lived in the same house, but we both went our own separate ways.
We stopped communicating, talking. You know, it just seemed to me like we was nowhere even close to the same page anymore.
Steve and Terry remained miserably married for 30 years. In 2003, Terry hit her breaking point.
After 30 years, I decided I couldn't stand it anymore. Things weren't going to change. They were always going to be the same way. So it was just time for me to leave. So I did. One day I just got up and left.
Even after the divorce was final, the two kept in touch for the sake of their grown son. But soon, Terry and Steve were dating other people. At her cousin's funeral, Terry started to realize something was missing in her life.
The preacher preached his service, and he said one line. He said, "It doesn't matter how many good deeds you do in your life, how many people you help across the street, till you've been saved, you won't go to heaven." And that weighed on my mind more than anything. No, God was not never a part of my life. I thought God was something that was for everybody else. I didn't know how to reach out. I didn't know how to get him into my life. I knew that something was missing, but I didn't know how to get it, and I didn't know where to go to get it.
3 years later, Terry's friends persuaded her to join them on a missions trip to the Gulf Coast. They were going to restore houses, something Terry loved to do. On the last night, she sat in a church service by the lake.
Pastor Brown, he did the invitational, and he said, "Anybody that wants to be saved, just come on up right now, and the Lord's ready." And I sat there, and all of a sudden, it was like God said to me, he said, "I got you here, the perfect place, this is it, it's your turn, come on home." And I went up front, and somebody came up with me, and they said, "All you have to do is repeat the good confession that Jesus is the Christ, my Lord and Savior." And I did that, and when I did that, it was physical. He came into my heart, it shook me. My heart opened up. It was on fire. It was just bright. It was white. It was clean. It was light. It was awesome. And from that day forward, my life has changed.
Terry began praying for a godly man, a man to love and marry and grow old with.
My life was changed, and I needed somebody. I wanted somebody to share it with, to spend the rest of my life with, a good Christian man to go to church and believe the same things I believed.
Terry told Steve she had become a Christian. He noticed an immediate change in her and even started going to church.
He saw changes in me, and I think he wanted part of that change.
Oh, I look forward to going to church.
Steve, too, became a Christian and was baptized 6 months later.
To see him baptized, it was an awesome thing because I knew the feeling that I got when I was baptized, the cleanliness and the forgiveness and the warmth and the love and acceptance. And I wanted him to have that. And to see the change come over him, and just to see him walk away from that, it's awesome. God can do anything.
Including answer Terry's prayer for a godly husband.
And that's what I prayed for. And he's cleaned Steve up, and he sent Steve back to me. And it's just my do-over. I get to do it again.
I wasn't for sure we could get along. I was not sure we could get along, you know, but I seen, you know, going to church with her and everything, she's got something going here, you know, something special. And, you know, I want to be a part of that.
After 5 years, Steve and Terry were married again on October 4th, 2008.
It was fantastic. The best part of the wedding, I mean, besides us getting married, was my whole family was there. And everybody sees the change. Everybody knows that this time, this is the next 30 years.
When I first got a glimpse of her, it just blew me away. It just, you know, it was like for the first time. All the air just left me. That just is a great feeling.
Our marriage is different this time because now I've got a friend. Steve wants to be my friend. He wants to be around me. He's not always looking to go someplace else, you know, and we're on the same path this time. God is very large in our life now. We go to church and we talk about the Bible. God is everything. God is acceptance and God is love and He's peace and He's everything you ever wanted in life. There is no need to look anyplace else. God is what you need. Everybody needs Him.
As we mentioned earlier, we find a lot of the people who call us are people who are struggling with problems in their marriage. They've tried to make the marriage work, But for a wide variety of reasons, that marriage has not worked, and it either is breaking up or about to break up. And they understand that there are a lot of things you can do to help improve a marriage, but ultimately, it's going to require outside assistance, outside counseling, in order to help you understand what went wrong. Sometimes marriages go wrong from the very get-go, from the very beginning. It's interesting to see how many people marry for the wrong kinds of reasons. They marry for what marriage will do for them rather than for what they can do for their partner. And right from the very beginning, a bad foundation is laid. Often marriages work fine for 2 or 3 years, but then all of a sudden things start to change. Nothing stays exactly the same. You know, the husband puts on a little weight and, you know, things begin to change in terms of backgrounds and attitudes and interests perhaps change. And pretty soon communication breaks down. You're no longer talking to each other. Children will come along and all of the attention that you used to put on each other now shifts to the children. And one or the other partner can feel left out and neglected. Often that's what happens to husbands. And all kinds of things can foul up a marriage. But the reality is that there is someone who can help you. There is a marriage counselor who's available to you 24/7. And you don't have to pick up a phone and you don't have to pay $200 an hour laying on some Canadian psychiatrist's couch necessarily, although psychiatrists can be helpful and physical counselors can be helpful. But we want you to be aware of the fact that God Himself has specialized in marriage counseling. As a matter of fact, He created the concept of marriage. Adam and Eve were married in the Garden of Eden. He told them to love one another and to prosper and to have many children so that His purposes could be accomplished. And this day, He wants to intervene in your marriage as well. We have some wonderful biblical teachings that will help put God and Jesus Christ at the center of your marriage. And if you'll call us at 877-431-7887 or 416-431-0700, we'll send you a little booklet entitled Love and Marriage. It's based on Scripture. It has some wonderful practical advice about how to keep your marriage alive, marriage vibrant, not just for 5 years or 25 years, but for 50 years and longer. God doesn't want you to divorce. He wants your relationship to remain strong, but He also knows that it can only happen if you will reach out to Him. And so this day, we would encourage you to call us and let us pray with you so that you can trust God to become the ultimate marriage counselor, to reconcile you to Him and to each other. So give us a call. We'll be back with more on Canadian Edition, so please stay with us. David Hall was $27,000 in debt, and he was using one credit card to pay off another. Then, in just 9 months, David tripled his income and paid all his bills. How'd he do it? It all started with a bet he made with a friend.
David Hall can afford to live just about anywhere, but he prefers living on a boat.
The scenery changes all the time. If you want to change where you live, you can keep the same house and drop your lines and find somewhere else to live. And
but just 5 years ago, he was struggling to make ends meet. David was a teacher making a modest salary. Before long, he was in over his head in credit card debt.
But I definitely felt like there was something missing in my life as far as understanding where the money was going. And it caused me to go into credit card debt. It caused me to buy things that I probably couldn't afford.
Before it was over, David was $27,000 in credit card debt.
And that's really sad. When you're living off a credit card and you're paying one off with the other and you're making minimum payments, and that kind of debt really puts anxiety on you.
Although David grew up in the church, he didn't understand the concept of tithing.
I always viewed it as an offering, and it could be anything, and whatever you had on you. If you had $20 and you had things you had to do that afternoon, or you had bills you had to pay, you might not put it in the plate.
Then one day, a friend challenged his beliefs on tithing.
He said, how could God ever trust you with a lot, since he can't even trust you with a little? And I got to say, that really broadsided me.
His friend proposed a gentleman's wager.
He said, you start tithing right now, just on your teaching salary. Step out on faith, and in a year's time, you'll never worry about funds or finances again for the rest of your life. And I did this.
David started tithing faithfully. At the same time, he started a DJ and karaoke company.
And I started doing a few little weddings and things like that. And God just absolutely stepped up. It was amazing. I went from famine to feast in a flash.
Within 9 months, David's income tripled.
It was unbelievable. It truly was. And that, just to think that you're now spending more money, you're now giving more than you were before, but you're getting so much more back, it just blew my mind. And every year since has just been better and better.
David paid off his credit card debt. Today, his business, Coastal Karaoke, employs 18 DJs and is still growing. He wants to get the message out about giving. In fact, his company motto reads, "Enjoying Blessings of the Tithe." It's even on his license plates. David's also a CBN partner and wants people to know it's about more than money.
Tithing is not about the money. He does not need your money. He needs your obedience. And he says, if you're obedient to my word, I will provide for you. God wants the very best for us. And in wanting the very best for us, he expects our very best.
You know, one of the things that often frustrates people about the Christian faith is something we call a paradox. It doesn't make sense on the surface. It seems to be a conflict. For example, in order to live, we have to die. To get eternal life, we have to be willing to die to this life and to accept Jesus Christ's death on the cross to save us. And in order to prosper, we have to be willing to give. We need a spirit that is willing to give it all away in order for God to be able to bless us and trust us with abundance. Where are you today in terms of your own sense about your possessions? Are you hoarding it for yourself? The more you keep it for yourself, the more you hoard it, the less likely it is that God will be able to bless you with more. He wants to bless us so that we in turn can use what He's given us to bless others. And what we need is some good, solid biblical teaching on stewardship, how God views money, how God expects us to use money. You know, it's not money that's the problem. It's the love of money, Jesus said, that creates all of the sin and problems in people's lives. And so we want you to love God first and then receive what He gives you in terms of blessing, financial blessing specifically in this case, so that you in turn can use it to bless others. And in order to do that, we've prepared some wonderful teaching called A Guide to Financial Freedom. And we'll send it to you without any cost or obligation. All you have to do is call us at 877-431-7887 or 416-431-0700. You can also go to our website, CanadianEdition.com, and request it that way if you'd prefer to get it over the internet. We'd be happy to deliver it to you in that fashion as well. But we believe that God does want to prosper you if you're willing to use that prosperity to bless others rather than to serve your own needs. So give us a call, 877-431-7887 or 416-431-0700, and ask for A Guide to Financial Freedom. Now, one of the things we love to do is to take your questions. You can send them to us through the mail. You can call them to us over the phone numbers that we've just given to you, or you can go on CanadianEdition.com and send them to us. But we have a question from Lee that came from one of our recent partner events. And so, Lee, what's your question?
David, what would you say is the spiritual temperature in Canada?
Very good question. What is the spiritual temperature of Canada? Well, my response is it depends where you are. There are certain places in Canada where God is moving in a miraculous way. We talk about the Bible Belt out west where the churches are prospering and God is doing some tremendous things. There are several local churches that are doing incredible work. The Spirit is moving. God is blessing. They're reaching out into the communities. And if you're a part of a church like that, you would say the spiritual temperature where I am is high. hot, hot, hot because the Holy Spirit has lit a fire under people. But there are also places across our nation where it's pretty cold spiritually. Not much is going on. And God needs people just like you to begin moving in obedience to Him to light the fires of revival in our nation. You know, so often we think about what has gone wrong in our country in terms of where we've denied God or rejected God or moved God out of the public square. And yeah, that does have an impact in terms of a nation's spiritual climate and spiritual temperature. But ultimately, God has called us as Christians to influence that temperature. Now, you probably have a thermostat in your house, and thermostats are different than thermometers. Thermometers only tell you what the temperature is. Thermostats not only tell you what the temperature is, but they also regulate it. And one of our problems in Canada, can I be really frank? I think we have too many Christians who think that their job is to be a thermometer, just to measure the temperature and report on it. And some think, well, okay, it's hot here, it's cold here. But the reality is God has called us as Bible-believing, Spirit-filled Christians to be thermostats, to be regulating and influencing. Another metaphor that Jesus uses is salt and light. If we find that our country is spoiling, that there's a lot of spoilage spiritually, it's because there's not enough salt. If we feel like Canada is darkening from coast to coast spiritually, it's because we have hid our light, as Jesus said, under a bushel rather than put it on a stand or on a hill so it could be seen for miles. And so ultimately, the answer to Canada's climate in terms of its spiritual climate, its spiritual temperature, is on your shoulders and mine. We have to live in obedience to Jesus Christ. We have to be out there doing the work that Christ has called us to, visiting those people who are in prison, extending compassion to people who are in need, feeding the hungry, looking after the widows and orphans, to live out our Christian faith. So if you're comfortable being a thermometer today, I'd like to reach out and throw your thermometer away and rewire you so that you can become a thermostat. Because as we get the fire of the Holy Spirit in our own hearts and minds, and as we're obedient to the Word of God as revealed by the Holy Spirit, then we're able to regulate the temperature, the spiritual temperature around us. And you don't have to do that by yourself. You need people to stand with you in prayer to do that. And 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700 puts you in touch with prayer warriors who see themselves as thermostats. They're ready to turn up the temperature, turn up the heat in your life and their own to make a difference for the kingdom. And again, as always, 24/7, those phone lines are available, but also our website, CanadianEdition.com. Go out now and be a thermostat and not a thermometer. God bless you. We'll see you next time on Canadian Edition.
A father's love. Imagine a love even greater than this, the love of God, eternal, unchanging, unfailing.
For more information, or if you'd like to help continue the ministry of Canadian Edition, please write to us with your gift today. Our address is CBA, Post Office Box 700, Scarborough, Ontario, M1S 4T4. Become a 700 Club partner and write today.